Thank you all for joining. We're just going to give one more minute for people to get settled and in the room. Thank you. We'll be starting in just a minute. Hello, everyone, and welcome. I'm Nina Sadowski, the program director for NYU Los Angeles, and it is my distinct pleasure to have you join us this evening for this presentation, Mastering the Art of Strategic Communication, Lessons from 2020. I think we can all agree that 2020 was quite a year. I don't know, we'll see how we feel about 2020 after 21's over. But I think we all felt a little little battered and bruised by last year. And I think that a lot of what our guest today will talk about will really show why we're all battered and bruised. And that is because we have had a lot of communication thrust at us, particularly when we've been home alone and isolated during the pandemic. And how do we know it's effective? And how do we cut through the wheat and the chaff? I'm really pleased today to introduce Jillian Straus, who is a long-term media veteran with stints at Oprah and ABC. Her business is exactly this, in strategic communication. She is the founder and CEO of Straus Communications, and we will put up information at the end with her website if any of you are interested in contacting her beyond this event. Jillian has worked as a presentation trainer, speech writer, media trainer for CEOs, entrepreneurs, athletes, celebrities, and authors. I think that this is going to be fascinating. I've had a little preview, so I know it will be. And I will just say that you can drop, we will have time for a Q&A at the end, which we will, so please drop any questions in the Q&A. I'm gonna turn it over to Jillian now, although I understand we are beginning with a video clip. So I'm going to turn my video and sound off and allow Ms. Straus to take it away. Again, thank you very much, everyone who is joining us. We really value your participation in these discovery sessions, and we hope that they are bringing value to you. All right, let's go on with the show.
This is a flu. This is like a flu.
What do you say to Americans who are watching you right now who are scared?
I say that you're a terrible reporter. That's what I say.
Hydroxychloroquine.
I'm taking it. Hydroxychloroquine. Right now, yeah.
That's a drug that the president has directed us to take a closer look at.
Supposing you brought the light inside the body, which you can do either through the skin or in some other way. Right, and then I see the disinfectant where it knocks it out in a minute, 1 minute. And is there a way we can do something like that by injection inside or almost a cleaning?
I wanted to always play it down. I still like playing it down.
Yes, sir.
Because I don't want to create a panic.
It's also more deadly than your strenuous flus.
We here standing together. Mm-hmm. I need everybody to stand with us. If you're not with us, you're against us.
Say his name, George Floyd!
If you have a problem figuring out whether you're for me or Trump, and you ain't black.
I just left Walter Reed Medical Center, and I learned so much about coronavirus. Don't let it dominate you. Don't be afraid of it.
What a testament it is to Joe's character that he had the audacity to break one of the most substantial barriers that exists in our country and select a woman as his vice president. But while I may be the first woman in this office, I will not be the last.
I use a favorite term that all of you
you people really came up with. We will stop the steal. Today, I will lay out just some of the evidence proving that we won this election and we won it by a landslide.
Wow, what a year it's been. There is so much we can learn from public speaking from this year's leaders and newsmakers. First, I just want to take a quick poll. How many of you think that public speaking is a matter of inherent talent? Either you have it or you don't. And how many of you think it's an acquired skill or a learned skill? Take a minute. Wow, I'm glad to see that more of you think that it's a learned skill. It looks like 98% of you. That's exactly right. In all my years of working with CEOs and executives, entrepreneurs, professional athletes, and authors, some of the people who were the most nervous to give a speech, through some coaching, they actually became fabulous presenters, and now they really enjoy it. So I want to share with you today some of the secrets that I taught them. One caveat before we begin, the people that I've chosen to highlight here today, I'm looking at them solely through the lens of their communication skills. It's not about their policy or their politics. We can learn something from their mistakes as well as their successes. Today, I'm going to share with you five secrets to being a great communicator using examples from familiar faces. You've all seen them this year. Additionally, you'll learn the power that words have to make an impact, to move people, and to actually change behavior. And then I'm going to teach you some tips and tricks to making your own presentations better. We'll review them at the end. I'll offer a few more takeaways, and then I'll take some questions. So let's start with the five secrets to great communication. One, show your human side. Two, tell stories. Three, let the facts speak for themselves. Four, send a clear, concise, and consistent message. And five, make it about your audience and not about yourself. I want you to write these down as we go through each, and I want you to think about, how can you use these tactics in the next speech that you have coming up? Or if there's nothing on the horizon, maybe think about the last speech you gave and how could you have applied these to that speech? Number one, show your human side. Great communicators, they engage your mind and they touch your heart. The Prime Minister of New Zealand, Jacinda Ardern, has been credited with one of the best response to COVID. Only 25 people died in her country compared to other countries around the world where we saw hundreds of thousands of deaths. Let's take a look at one of her early addresses that she posted on Facebook.
Evening, everyone. That I would jump online quickly and just check in with everyone, really. As we all prepare to hunker down for a few weeks. Excuse the casual attire. It can be a messy business putting toddlers to bed, so I'm not in my work clothes, so forgive me for that. I do just want to prepare everyone that because of the lag with COVID-19, the time from someone having contact with someone who has it, catching it themselves, them being symptomatic, and being tested and positive, is a number of days before all of that happens. So we won't see the positive benefits of all of the effort you're about to put in for self-isolation for a few days yet, quite a number of days. I'd say at least 10 days. So don't be disheartened. Till then, do check in on your neighbors. Do especially check on those who may be elderly. Give them a call, see what their needs are. And if you can help them, go out and grab their essentials and pop them on the front door for them. Stay at home, break the chain, and you'll save lives.
So here we see the Prime Minister in casual clothes, sharing that she's putting her children to bed. She's choosing to reveal an intimate side of herself that we rarely see from world leaders. She displays care and concern for her citizens while asking for their cooperation. She often signs off her addresses with "be strong and be kind." Not only has she become so popular during COVID, but she was also, more importantly, beyond having an 80% favorability rating, her approach has resulted in a public that listened and therefore stayed safe. Headlines like this one show that even when Jacinda Arlen's sold drastic lockdown with the straight talk and mom jokes. So even when she's asking people to do something as serious as locking down, her authority isn't undermined by showing her human side. In fact, it's her humanity that makes her even more authoritative. Let's take a look at another clip where she takes the time to talk to a childhood educator about lockdown a few weeks later.
Any little rituals you've started as a family that are really helping pass the time or helping keep a sense of connection and structure to your day?
Yeah, I think what we're doing is more meals around the dining table than we do on a normal school day. Often, because the kids are heading out the door and I'm putting lunchboxes or my husband's putting lunchboxes together, we don't sit down and have breakfast with them, but we have been during lockdown and we have been spending lunch together, and we don't normally do that until the weekend. And even then, the kids are here, there and everywhere, so we might not get to do that. But dinner time, and we're doing, you know, little things like candlelit dinners and getting dressed up.
How much pressure do we put on the children to complete quality works? Because you're using some great tips from keeping kids engaged. Is engagement the main thing, or do we worry about quality at the moment as well?
I think a lot of what the educationists are saying is that if you can encourage the kids to try and keep some structure and to keep working forward, then that would be fantastic. And focus on the subjects that you really enjoy. But it is about enjoying this time because it's stressful.
By interviewing an expert about how to keep our children sane through the pandemic shows us that she understands the sacrifice that she's asking families to make. And she's literally putting herself in the shoes of her citizens. And that was instrumental to making them feel connected to her and therefore earning their compliance to these really strict lockdown orders. It's hard to imagine any of our past presidents engaging in such a conversation. The next speech I want to share with you propelled Atlanta Mayor Keisha Lance Bottoms onto the national stage. Her unscripted 4-minute address came hours after protests turned to mayhem in her city. Let's take a look at that.
Above everything else, I am a mother. I am a mother to 4 Black children in America, one of whom is 18 years old. And when I saw the murder of George Floyd, I hurt like a mother would hurt. And on yesterday, when I heard there were rumors about violent protests in Atlanta, I did what a mother would do. I called my son and I said, "Where are you?" I said, "I cannot protect you, and Black boys shouldn't be out today. So you're not gonna out-concern me and out-care about where we are in America. I wear this each and every day, and I pray over my children each and every day. So what I see happening on the streets of Atlanta is not Atlanta. This is not a protest. This is not in the spirit of Martin Luther King Jr. This is chaos. A protest has purpose. When Dr. King was assassinated, we didn't do this to our city. So if you love this city that has had a legacy of Black mayors and Black police chiefs and people who care about this city, where more than 50% of the business owners in Metro Atlanta are minority business owners, if you care about this city, then go home.
Her anger is palpable and her passion is contagious. By showing such raw emotions, you can feel her pain, and so you become invested in her message. Nothing engages people more than passion, and nothing moves them more. Her speech was an effective one because within 2 days, order was restored in her city. The bottom line is, you can't move people if you yourself are not fired up. Passion is contagious and persuasive. Passion can be a very powerful tool when it comes to communication, so use it. Many people have called Joe Biden's empathy his superpower. This headline, "Joe Biden's empathy may boost US foreign policy," really is an example of the concrete impact that showing your human side can have. It's always a good idea to show your human side when you're public speaking, but particularly in a crisis like this one. Let's take a look at the speech he gave the day before he became the president.
Look, you know, you've all, it's kind of emotional for me. But look, you've been with me my whole career, and through the good times and the bad. Well, excuse the emotion, but when I die, Delaware will be written on my heart. I am proud, 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 proud to be a son of Delaware. And I am even more proud to be standing here doing this from the Major Bo Biden facility. Ladies and gentlemen, I only have one regret. He's not here, because we should be introducing him as president.
As you can see from his speech, he isn't afraid to be vulnerable. It's his loss and his tears that make him so relatable to hundreds and thousands of Americans who have also lost loved ones. Biden isn't known for being particularly charismatic or eloquent. He's probably known for his public speaking gaffes more, but he is really at his best when he is personal. It's his vulnerability that makes him relatable. And that is what creates authenticity. It's when Biden is emotive, not when he's talking policy, that he builds a connection with his audience. And we feel like we know him. That is what the audience craves. Because when you like, when you know and you like the messenger, you trust the message. What all these examples have in common is that all of these people are being real. I've worked with so many interesting, famous people over the years, and the one question I get asked all the time is, what is Oprah really like? And I always say she's exactly how she seems on TV. And what I mean by that is she oozes authenticity. That is what made her so popular. What you see is what you get. And that's what you're striving for as a public speaker. When you give an address, you want to give people a chance to see who you really are. Otherwise, they may feel a disconnect. If you're still not buying into this idea that you should show your human side, your personal side when at work or in your business communication, I want to share a quick story with you. Years ago, I had a client, a CEO of a very large company. She was giving an address in front of 10,000 people. The company was based in a country that's known more for keeping a stiff upper lip, but I urged her to show her human side. She was the first woman to hold that position in the company, and so she was hesitant to share her personal side, but ultimately, I convinced her to share her journey to the top, balancing work and family, and her address was remarkably well received. Other women in the company felt that their struggle balancing work and family was validated, and they started to see the company as a company that really cared, even though no policy changes were made at the company. And productivity and loyalty shot up right after she made that speech. I want you to write down what emotion you could have expressed that could have improved the last speech that you gave, or maybe a speech that you have coming up. Ask yourself, how could you have harnessed passion for an idea or a product or a cause to make a powerful presentation. The second secret to great communication is to tell stories. This may not be new to you, but I cannot undersell the value of storytelling when you're presenting to a group. Research shows that messages delivered as stories can be up to 22 times more memorable. Let me show you an example of this. New York Governor Andrew Cuomo often used stories to make a point and to cushion the blow of the number of coronavirus deaths in his daily briefings. Let's take a look.
Dear Mr. Cuomo, I seriously doubt that you will ever read this letter, as I know you are busy beyond belief with the disaster that has befallen our country. We are a nation in crisis. Of that, there is no doubt. I am a retired farmer hunkered down in northeast Kansas with my wife, who has but one lung and occasional problems with her remaining lung. She also has diabetes. We are in our 70s now, and frankly, I am afraid for her. Enclosed, find a solitary N95 mask left over from my farming days. It has never been used. If you could, would you please give this mask to a nurse or doctor in your state? I have kept 4 masks for my immediate family. Please keep on doing what you do so well, which is to lead. Sincerely, Dennis and Sharon. A farmer in northeast Kansas. His wife has one lung and diabetes. He has 5 masks. He sends one mask to New York for a doctor or a nurse, keeps 4 masks. You want to talk about a snapshot of humanity. You have 5 masks. What do you do? Do you keep all 5? Do you hide the 5 masks? Do you keep them for yourselves or others? No. You send one mask to New York to help a nurse or a doctor.
I'm from New York, so I probably watched most of the briefings from the first 100 days. And after all of those hours, it is this story that I remember the most. It actually makes me a little teary when I hear it. Notice how the governor chooses to highlight the story of a selfless farmer when the country was collectively scared, bringing us together in a positive way when we were all physically isolated. Storytelling isn't just memorable. Scans of the human brain show us that the brain is actually more active when we hear stories rather than facts and figures. In other words, stories make people care in a way that statistics can't. When you hear that more than 400,000 Americans died of COVID, it doesn't move you the same way it does when you hear the story of Jason Hargrove, a bus driver from Detroit, does. Let's take a look at that.
This coronavirus shit is for real. And we out here as public workers doing our job, trying to make an honest living to take care of our families. But for you to get on the bus and stand on the bus and cough several times without covering up your mouth, and you know that we in the middle of a pandemic, that lets me know that some folks don't care. Listen, I'm mad right about now because that shit was uncalled for. And I'm trying to be the professional that they want me to be. And I kept my mouth closed. I'm out here, we out here, we moving the city around back and forth, trying to do our jobs and be professional about what we do. It's people like her who don't take shit for real why this shit is still existing and still spreading.
Jason sadly died of COVID a few days after posting this video on Facebook. You may not remember next year the grim statistics of COVID, but his raw words and his story of courage, I'm sure you'll never forget. His story also underscores that Public persuasive communication is no longer limited to giving a speech at a podium or a presentation at work. It could be on YouTube, it could be on Twitter or Facebook. All these forms of communication, what I'm teaching you today applies to all these forms of communication. It's so important for you to be able to tell your own story. And if you're an entrepreneur, you should be able to tell the story of your business. Whether you're giving a commencement speech, a keynote address, at a conference, or pitching your startup, being able to share what is unique about you, your background, your company, and your passion helps people to understand and see your perspective. The more personal, the better. Telling stories can be instrumental to your business presentations by helping you sell a product or an idea. Right now, we're living at a time where PowerPoints dominate, particularly now that we're all on Zoom. But a great story can demonstrate an idea for your audience in a way they'll never forget, in a way that no slide ever can. I want you to jot down one or two personal stories that may have enhanced your last speech or can help with your next one, and practice telling your own story. Don't forget, it's the details of the story that help us to feel, see, and hear. They help us to experience, and they will help you engage with your audience and connect to you. The third secret is to let the facts speak for themselves. Elvis Presley once said, "The truth is like the sun. You can shut it out for a time, but it ain't going away." President Trump learned that lesson the hard way. Let's take a look at some of the lies he told us this year.
Have you been briefed by the CDC?
I have.
Are the words about a pandemic at this point?
No, we're not at all, and we have it totally under control. It's one person coming in from China, and we have it under control. It's going to be just fine.
We're trying to engage in radical transparency with the American public.
It's going to disappear. One day, it's like a miracle. It will disappear.
The excess mortality rate is way down and much lower than almost any other country.
Anybody that needs a test gets a test. They're there. They have the tests. And the tests are beautiful.
It affects elderly people with heart problems and other problems. But it affects virtually nobody.
We're rounding the turn. We're rounding the corner. It's going away.
Did President Trump intentionally mislead the American people about the threat of COVID, a pandemic that has now cost the lives of nearly 200,000 Americans?
Absolutely not.
We were getting ready to win this election. Frankly, we did win this election. We did win this election.
So this year has truly been unprecedented. And although Trump has enjoyed immense popularity over the years, I think it's fair to say after watching these clips that telling the truth wasn't his strong suit. There were a lot of consequences to that. One, the election. Two, being impeached a second time and possibly being banned from Twitter. But why does telling the truth matter when it comes to public speaking? It matters because transparency is the currency of trust. I would argue that one of the reasons why Trump was so popular in the first place is because of his daily tweets. On Twitter, he was unfiltered, unapologetic, and politically incorrect. People love that kind of openness. But that kind of openness, that kind of transparency, was severely undermined when the facts showed quite the opposite of his words. Facts do speak for themselves and they speak loudly, but it's hard for someone to tell you the sky is red when clearly you can see with your own eyes it's blue. It became really hard to ignore headlines like this one that called Trump the alternative facts president. The illusion of transparency that he created on Twitter was destroyed by the lies, and people could no longer trust the message because they could no longer trust the messenger. By contrast, let's take a look at Governor Cuomo's approach, who enjoyed high favorability ratings while Trump's favorability plummeted. He was one of the most popular politicians during the pandemic. In deliberate contrast to Trump, he gave us the facts daily in his coronavirus briefings. Let's take a look.
We make decisions based on facts. Based on the numbers, New York City numbers down. These numbers are now down. But Facts change. It sounds inconsistent. We like to think a fact is always a fact. No, facts change. COVID facts change dramatically, and they change often.
Not only did he give us the facts, he did so in almost mind-numbing detail. Percentages, graphs, charts. Every day for almost a year, he gave us so much data, sometimes it felt like we were getting a science lesson. But this was all an effort to create transparency. He leveraged this transparency to get people to buy into staying at home, wearing masks, and social distancing. It took him months, but he used truth and transparency to create that trust. His briefings worked like clockwork. They were on every day at 11. They were predictable, they were organized, and they were usually under an hour. And when he chose to give his opinion, he labeled it as opinion rather than stating it like it was a fact. By contrast, the White House briefings happened inconsistently. They would drag on for hours, often featuring Trump using superlatives like the tests were beautiful and the administration was doing a fantastic job. Cuomo used the power of communication so effectively, he actually won an Emmy for it. But even more importantly, his transparency helped to turn the once COVID-ridden state into one of the lowest with one of the lowest infection rates in the country. Now let's see how the importance of transparency plays out in business communication. Here's how Marriott CEO Arne Sorensen addressed his company during the pandemic.
COVID-19 is like nothing we've ever seen before. For a company that's 92 years old, that's borne witness to the Great Depression, World War II, and many other economic and global crises, that's saying something. But here are the facts. COVID-19 is having a more severe and sudden financial impact on our business than 9/11 and the 2009 financial crisis combined. If there is any good news visible today, it is the signs of early recovery in Greater China. China appears to have succeeded in reducing the spread of COVID-19 through strong counteractions. China is now bringing manufacturing back online, and we are seeing some early signs of lodging demand begin to return. If this holds, it may bode well for the course of this epidemic in other parts of the world. In 2 weeks, I will mark my 8th anniversary as CEO, a position I accepted on the heels of 2 legends in hospitality. As a leader, I've experienced so many wonderful highs and a good number of challenging lows. I can tell you that I have never had a more difficult moment than this one. There is simply nothing worse than telling highly valued associates, people who are the very heart of this company, that their roles are being impacted by events completely outside of their control. I've never been more determined to see us through than I am at this moment. While it's impossible to know how long this crisis will last, I know we as a global community will come through the other side, and that when we do, our guests will be eager to travel this beautiful world again. When that great day comes, we will be there to welcome them with the warmth and care we are known for the world over.
Notice how he doesn't lie or sugarcoat the truth or try to spin the facts. No one likes to share bad news, and you can see he was actually pained to do so, but his straightforward approach of sharing the grim reality mixed with his personal and his emotion went down a lot easier with a dose of optimism. As a result, his video message was lauded by companies around the globe. Trump once justified his inaccuracies by saying he was trying to be a cheerleader for the country. But I think Arne Sorensen was a true cheerleader here by engaging in radical transparency, offering genuine, authentic emotion, and a little bit of hope. Transparency is so important to creating trust that now, even though the prior administration is no longer in power, Biden's team has to work overtime to build back that trust. Here's how they began on day one.
When the president asked me to serve in this role, we talked about the importance of bringing truth and transparency back to the briefing room. And he asked me to ensure we are communicating about the policies across the Biden-Harris administration and the work his team is doing every single day on behalf of all American people. There will be times when we see things differently in this room, I mean, among all of us. That's okay. That's part of our democracy, and rebuilding trust with the American people will be central to our focus in the press office and in the White House every single day.
So you can see from these early briefings with Jennifer Psaki, you can observe her mild manner, calm tone. It's really a stark contrast from Kayleigh McEnany, who is much more combative. Psaki, when she doesn't know the answers to the question, she always says, "I'll circle back," which creates this appearance of transparency, like the White House has nothing to hide. For now, Biden and Cuomo seem to be engaging in full transparency, but it just takes one lie to undermine the public's trust. Right now in New York, there are a lot of questions about whether Cuomo's team was truthful about the number of nursing home deaths. Only time will tell. But if in fact there was an attempt to hide the truth, perhaps the trust will be damaged irreparably. The fourth secret is to send a clear, concise, and consistent message. Wear a mask or go to jail. That's a pretty clear, concise message. This photo was taken from the 1918 pandemic. It's a stark contrast to the mask ambiguity that we have today. Sometimes the best way to send a clear message or to reinforce a message is to use a visual like that one. Unfortunately, the message early in this pandemic hasn't been quite so clear. In March, the respected Dr. Fauci told this to the American people on 60 Minutes.
There's a lot of confusion among people and misinformation surrounding face masks. Can you discuss that?
The masks are important for someone who's infected to prevent them from infecting someone else. Now, when you see people and look at the films in China and South Korea, whatever, everybody's wearing a mask. Right now in the United States, people should not be walking around with masks.
You're sure of it? Because people are listening really closely to this.
Right now, people should not be walking. There's no reason to be walking around with a mask. When you're in the middle of an outbreak, wearing a mask might make people feel a little bit better, and it might even block a droplet, but it's not providing the perfect protection that people think that it is. And often, there are unintended consequences. People keep fiddling with the mask, and they keep touching their face.
And can you get some schmutz sort of staying inside there?
Of course, of course. But when you think masks, you should think of healthcare providers needing them and people who are ill. The people who, when you look at the films of foreign countries and you see 85% of the people wearing masks, that's fine. That's fine. I'm not against it. If you want to do it, that's fine.
But it can lead to a shortage of
masks.
Exactly.
That's the point. It could lead to a shortage of masks for the people who really need it.
Given what we know now, it's hard to believe that Fauci actually said those words. This message not only hurt his credibility in the early days, it undermined the administration, it caused mass confusion, and it laid the groundwork for the mask to become a political tool. Let's look at an interview on the Today Show with Alex Azar, which really highlights how conflicted the messages were.
Let me ask you about his statements on masks, because to be diplomatic about it, it's been all over the place. I'll play some examples.
The concept of a mask is good, but it also does, you're constantly touching it, you're touching your face. There are a lot of people think the masks are not good.
Masks are fine with me.
I think there's a lot of problems with masks. No,
vaccine. Is this helpful? I mean, once and for all, are masks necessary? Are masks going to make this pandemic less terrible than it is, basically?
Masks are important. We have been clear since the president has been clear since his April guidance on reopening.
Well, he hasn't been clear. I mean,
Savannah, it's right there, coronavirus.gov. The president's guidance on reopening: wear face coverings when you can't social distance. Very clear.
But isn't his voice louder than a CDC website? I mean, just in fairness.
Well, he says it. I say it, the FDA, CDC, NIH, that's all we talk about is wear face coverings when you cannot social distance.
What do you think then about the message that's sent when the president has his rallies and they might encourage mask wearing, but they don't require it? And, you know, people are out there not socially distanced. And when you ask about it, they say, well, it's your individual choice. I mean, can't the message be sent from the very top?
Well, our public health guidance is clear and unambiguous. Wash your hands, watch your distance, wear your face coverings when you can't be socially distant. And individuals just have to make calls for themselves about their own risk, the setting in their community, what's the spread of disease in their community, whether they have vulnerable people in their household. So at the end of the day, it's individual responsibility, but our guidance is very clear. The three W's, wash your hands, watch your distance, wear your face coverings when you can't watch your distance.
But individual responsibility affects others as well.
Well, we all saw firsthand how the mixed messages about masks and the inconsistency led to mask confusion and division. No matter what Alex Azar says, and no matter what the CDC posts on their website, the damage of Maskgate could not be undone. Well, how does this relate to your speech? You need to remember, you have to be clear, what is your agenda? Can you summarize that in a soundbite? Is your message clear? Is it consistent with your actions? Does it reflect your intention? And do you repeat that same message over so there's some consistency to it? Remember, people have short attention spans. It has to be brief, simple, and to the point. The fifth and final secret is to make it about your audience, not about yourself. One of the biggest mistakes people make when they give a speech is they think, what do I want to talk about? Instead, they should be asking, what do people want or need to hear? So before you do any presentation, you really need to do a little homework on your audience. Who is your audience? What is their age? What is their position? What do they care about? What do they want? And what is on their mind right now? My own advice was put to the test about 10 years ago when I had a client, a professional athlete who I trained for a television appearance. After I gave him my presentation on how to be a great television guest, I said to him, you know what, it's time to practice. And he said, I don't need to practice, I got this. And I said, no, we really need to practice this. You're gonna go on national TV in 2 days. And he said, I don't need to. Well, I realized in that moment, I had to appeal to him in his own language. And I had to get through to him in a way that he would understand. And I said to him, you wouldn't go out onto the field before a big game without practicing, would you? And he said, no. And I said, well, you're not gonna go on TV without practicing either. And I immediately got through to him. He practiced and he did great on television. So the point of that story is, if you want to become a better speaker, you have to appeal to someone in a way that they can best hear your message. In other words, before you can be a good speaker, you've got to be a good listener. So you don't want to speak at your audience. You want to speak to them. You want to be one with them. Julia Jackson, the mother of Jacob Blake, who was shot by a white police officer in Kenosha, Wisconsin, she did this so beautifully. Let's take a look at her speech.
God has placed each and every one of us in this country because he wanted us to be here. Clearly, you can see by now that I have beautiful brown skin, but take a look at your hand, and whatever shade it is beautiful as well.
Amen. Yes.
How dare we hate what we are? We are humans. God did not make one type of tree or flower or fish or horse or grass or rock. How dare you ask him to make one type of human that looks just like you? I'm not talking to just Caucasian people. I am talking to everyone. White, black, Japanese, Chinese, red, brown, No one is superior to the other. The only supreme being is God Himself. Please, let's begin to pray for healing for our nation. We are the United States. Have we been united? Do you understand what's going to happen when we fall? Because a house that is against each other cannot stand. To all of the police officers, I'm praying for you and your families. To all of the citizens, my black and brown sisters and brothers, I'm praying for you. I believe that you are an intelligent being just like the rest of us, everybody. Let's use our hearts, our love, and our intelligence to work together to show the rest of the world how humans are supposed to treat each other.
See how she talked about the audience and not about herself? Notice how she addressed people of all races, how she said she prayed for the officers. She didn't point fingers or vilify them or create any division. She uses the power of speech to literally embrace us. It's her poignant words that did the equivalent of putting her arms collectively around the crowd. That's exactly what you want to do. That is how you connect with your audience. When you're speaking in front of a large group, you might wonder to yourself, how can I create that connection? You know, I can't really have eye contact with hundreds of people. And you may be feeling intimidated as well. But you should focus in on one person who seems to really intently be listening and just deliver your speech to them. We spoke earlier about the comparison between the White House briefings and Governor Cuomo's briefings. You may recall that Trump always stood on the podium and he was higher than the audience, the press. And Governor Cuomo made the decision, and I assure you it was intentional, to sit down at his briefings, therefore putting himself on the same level as the media. Cuomo created a very affable relationship with the press as a result, and Trump had a much more adversarial one. So when you're public speaking, remember, everything, like I just told you, should be intentional. Everything you say and everything you do is sending a message. The next time you give a talk, ask yourself, is it possible to be seated on the same level as your audience? So can you sit instead of stand? Is your audience small enough to be in a circle? Can you get rid of a podium that divides you? Those are all ways to connect better with your audience. What about when your audience is so big, it's actually the whole world? Well, on Inauguration Day, when Biden was giving perhaps the most important address of his career, a day that was clearly his day, instead of making it about himself, he called it Democracy's Day. Let's take a look.
This is America's day. This is Democracy's Day, a day of history and hope, of renewal and resolve. Through a crucible for the ages, America has been tested anew, and America has risen to the challenge. Today, we celebrate the triumph not of a candidate, but of a cause, the cause of democracy. The people, the will of the people, has been heard, and the will of the people has been heeded. We've learned again that democracy is precious, democracy is fragile. And at this hour, my friends, democracy has prevailed.
His humility here is a stark contrast from what we usually see from world leaders. Notice you rarely hear him use the word I. One of the things I always ask my clients through the years is, what do you think is the most influential word in the English language? What do you think it is? Write it down or put it in the chat. Nobody ever guesses correctly. But the most powerful word is you, because what do we all care about? We care about ourselves. So here's a tip. Use the word you the next time you give a speech, when you're talking to a small crowd or even a larger one. It really perks up people's ears. If world leaders can grab our attention by using the simple word you, you should as well. Before I open up to questions, I just want to review the 5 secrets to great communication. 1, show your human side. 2, tell stories. 3, let the facts speak for themselves. 4, send a clear, concise, and consistent message. And 5, make it about your audience and not yourself. If you want to become a great communicator, don't just use one of these secrets. Use a combination. Governor Cuomo, who I've referred to, he wasn't particularly popular in New York before COVID, but by employing all of these tactics, he has really had a moment in this pandemic, and he's changed people's perception of him. If you haven't seen one of his briefings, you should really watch one. All of these secrets will help you to achieve what I perceive as the ultimate goal of any great public speaker. What I call the rule of 3 C's. You want to captivate your audience. That means you want to grab their attention. You want to engage them. You want to be concise, and you want to connect in all the ways we talked about, by being open, by being authentic. That is how you connect. For homework, I want you to watch people you consider to be great communicators, people you'd like to emulate. See, do they use the tools we talked about here today? Ask yourself, what did they do that you liked? What didn't they do? Did they captivate you? Did they connect with you? And were they concise enough? A final tip when it comes to your delivery, great communicators always take the time to thoughtfully prepare their remarks, but they don't sound overly scripted because that would lose authenticity. So instead of having a carefully crafted script, you should make yourself some bullet points and throw out the script. Thanks. Let's take some questions.
Thank you, Jillian. That was fantastic. Well, I'm going to start with a couple of questions. So, a lot of this, when you hear it, it makes really instinctive sense. You go, oh, of course, that makes so much sense. That's so great now that you've articulated that, it feels right. But I have a couple of questions for you. One is, how do you think like the advent of TikTok and Twitter and communicating in such a short period of time, you know, having to get across a message in just a few sentences or characters or frames, how do you think that has impacted your thinkings about communication strategy?
Well, I'm not a fan of it, but it's here and it's here to stay. I went to journalism school. And so when Twitter became a thing and people started using Twitter, especially Trump started using Twitter to make an announcement, I was like, this isn't a press release, you know, this is Twitter. But in the process, Twitter has become news. So it's here, we have to embrace it. But I do think one of the really big problems is there isn't enough time for fact checking. Mm-hmm. And as I said before, it's the truth and this transparency that is often sacrificed. So that's why I'm not a big fan of it. But it's here to stay, unfortunately.
All right, so that leads me logically into my next question, which is, we are coming out of, I hope, the land of alternative facts and, you know, a culture of where lying was, you know, seamless. I forget how many lies the Washington Post counted up Trump did over the course, 30,000 something, right? So, how is that slice of American life impacted? I mean, you know, you can see the emotional connection. I certainly felt that I felt to some speakers who were doing all the things that you advocate, right? But we're also coming out of this weird period where a lot of people have responded to exactly the opposite, inauthentic, all about me, narcissistic, not truthful. So how do you think that impacts and where do you think we go from here?
Well, I think people are going to be a little bit more critical going forward. The events of this year are going to spill over for a long time. Yes, some people might tap into a grand message or it may grab their attention for a little bit, But when you pull behind the curtain and you see that there may be some inconsistency or some mistruth, that is really where that transparency is compromised. So I do think, yes, we're all, we all could fall into, wow, that was a great speech and he said all these great things or she said all these great things. And you kind of believe it at first, but it's the inconsistency. We talked a lot about that. When the facts don't match up, or you say one thing is said and you see another happen, or one day you say it one way and the next day you see it the other way, which is kind of what we saw with this administration. Mm-hmm. I think people are pretty smart and they start to catch on.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's interesting because I think you're right on the whole, and certainly Trump's popularity, you know, was abysmal when he left office, but yet he still did connect with that hardcore contingency who seemed to respond to the exact inversion. They were, you know, obfuscation, lies, changing of temperament, you know, disconnects between, you know, morality stated and morality lived, you know, I mean, so I find that sort of fascinating. So here's my next question is, do you have an idea about how we deprogram all those people? How do we communicate across the aisle so we say to people what you're believing isn't true? Do you have any ideas about that?
I mean, I think there's gonna be a lot of books written about this. I think this would veer out of the public speaking and onto identity politics and race relations and many more things. But I do think that Trump did a very good job of painting a picture of himself as the other, you know, the anti-swamp, the anti-establishment. People want that so bad that even if they're not really getting it, even if they are getting lies and a very authoritarian president who doesn't seem to care, it takes them a while to say, you know what, this isn't what he said it was going to be. So I think that's part of the problem. It was what Trump represented that people still cling to.
Right. I think we all have a tendency, whether it's with a politician or, you know, in our romantic lives, to kind of develop an idea and then find the support, the thoughts, and find the evidence to support the idea we want to see. Right?
Absolutely.
In any new relationship. So here's a question from the audiences, about one of the audience members, about your practices. And can these best practices be equitably or implemented in written communication versus verbal? I mean, I guess the question is, would you say these apply to speech, just speeches, or also to written communication?
Yeah, I mean, I'm more of an expert on the spoken word, but I absolutely have trained clients who've told me that they communicate better over email, even after they've learned some of these secrets. I think we all could learn to be more concise. I think we all could learn to say exactly what we mean, whether it's in a report or on an email. So I think a lot of them do apply.
So what is the, you said you wanted to give the audience some homework and, you know, ask them to observe people. Are there things that you would suggest for people to do on terms of their presentation skills to flex, you know, flex those muscles, or things that they can practice at home or, you know, talking to a friend or a spouse to try to get their chops going? What do you think there?
Yeah, I think that, I mean, one, you should really, when you watch television now, we're all still watching a lot of television, what else is there to do, right? You really should look more critically at those speakers. Are they doing the kinds of things that I talked about? Things that maybe you saw them all the time and you didn't really notice that they were doing anything, but everything they do is intentional. The way they stand, where they stand, how they stand, what they say. So just start to be a little bit more tapped in to notice those things. Mm-hmm. And then you can start to employ those intentional actions in your speech as well. And I think everybody should practice their own story, telling their own story, whether it's their work story, how they got where they are in their career, if they started a business, how and why they built that business, or even just their own personal journey, maybe even through this year. And just having to put that into a soundbite or into a short kind of edited version that you could practice in front of somebody else is just it's a good way to practice your speaking skills.
That's a great idea. I actually love that idea of as an exercise, trying to craft sort of your pitch about what this year was, because, you know, this year, you know, hard for everyone, certainly, and a lot of different reactions. But I think that a lot of us have had, you know, real sort of epiphanies or done some real soul searching. I've found that certainly among my community and among, you know, the NYU community, people are really, you know, looking at themselves. And so I think looking back through this year, what it meant as a way of positioning to where you'd like to go on the other side would be an excellent thing to be prepared. So,
and a lot of people are having to pivot in what they're doing. You know, maybe they don't have that much work and they have to explain to a client they're pitching what they've been doing in the pandemic while, you know, not over advertising that they haven't had that much work, or maybe they're looking for a new job. And so they have to say what they've been doing in the past year, taking care of their families. So being able to create a narrative where you control it and it isn't someone looking at your resume and making assumptions about you. That's why telling your story is so powerful, because you get to control the way people think about it, as opposed to just the facts, right? I mean, yes, you need the facts, but you can shape it in a way that showcases what you want to showcase.
Yeah, you know, that's fascinating, because that's a lot of what I teach when I teach writing, and a lot of what I also, you know, rely on for my own writing brand, right, is that, you know, finding that succinct story and getting ahead of it, positioning it, right, so that you're the one telling the narrative, as opposed to letting someone pick the narrative from the facts.
Absolutely.
Okay, so I have a few more audience questions. This is from Christina. How can you stay focused and be intentional without overthinking, especially if you tend to freeze in public speaking situations? I bet a lot of people in the audience relate to that question.
That's really a good one. Right. Listen, I mean, I haven't spoken for an hour in a presentation like this on Zoom. It's, you know, you want to be engaged with your audience. You want to make sure your slides are working. You want to keep up with every line. You don't want to lose your place. So I understand what you're saying. You want it to feel natural, but you want it to be purposeful. And how do you do that? I mean, it isn't easy, but I think that the key is what I said, is to know your material and to know what your agenda is and to know what your intention is. And practice your speech and know it. But then at a certain point, you know, just try to speak a little bit. I don't want to say straight from the heart, because it is from what you prepared, but try to go off script when you can and go to the core messages.
Mm-hmm. This is another audience question. Do you recommend taking classes, whether they be acting classes, perhaps, to get in touch with yourself, or courses that push you to practice public speaking?
I don't recommend you take acting classes. I do know people who do what I do, and they actually have an acting background. One of the reasons why I love what I do is I myself had a fear of public speaking. And I was always, when I worked at Oprah, I was always behind the scenes, right? I didn't have to go on camera. I didn't have to be the one to talk. I would just tell other people what to say and what to do. And then I myself wrote a book and I had to go on television. And that was very intimidating for me. So I hired someone to media train me. And I realized that anybody can overcome this. Anybody can overcome their fear and learn a few skills and be good at it. Very few people have a God-given talent for it.
So here's a question from Gus. Do you think the last 4 years have trained us to be more sensitive to public lies? Do you think we're forewarned, basically?
That's a really good question. I think that we're more skeptical. I think that we used to believe that if the president of the United States told us something on a podium, behind a podium, that it was a fact. And clips just like the montage I showed you, all of the lies, we saw so many, you know, we saw that so many times on the news this year. And then we saw the Bob Woodward interview. So I think people realize that, you know, things are not always as they appear. And they're really craving that transparency that I talked about. I think it's going to take the new administration a long time to build that trust. And no administration is perfect. They're going to have some missteps, and they're going to have things that they don't want to be completely transparent about. So they have quite a mountain to climb on that front.
Yeah. And I think that we do too. But I actually think that Gus is right. I do think that we are. I mean, I think we are more sensitive. I think if the last 4 years have taught us anything, it is that we cannot rely on any one source, right? That what you were saying before, and that's sort of the limitations of social media as an information.
And that's a good thing, right? We shouldn't just watch one channel or read one publication. We need to get our news from many sources. But I'm sure that you've noticed in the pandemic, because so much of, we're limited in our behavior with COVID, that people are choosing the facts that work the best for what they want to do, right? So they're choosing like, oh, I think it's fine to go on an airplane, or I think it's fine to, go see a friend at their house. People are choosing facts that help them to live their lives the way they want to live them. So I think this idea of choosing certain facts is very specific to this time as well.
Right. I think you're right. We're isolated and we're looking for comfort, not challenge, right? So think that, that confirmation bias question.
Mm-hmm.
So here's an interesting nuanced question from Julie Branson, who says, as a speechwriter for cabinet members and a co-organizer for TEDx events, cool, Julie, I find telling your story has been oversold. People focus on their own story. Can you talk a little about how to use, when to use, and to what degree a speaker should include their story?
Oh, I think that's a really, really great point. I always think that when you share a story, whether it's your own story or another story, there has to be a specific point and purpose to it. You don't just tell a story because it's entertaining. It has to have it has to relate to a point that you're making. That's why every clip you saw here today, I labored over. I said, what does this clip, not just is this a good clip of someone who's a good speaker, is it fun to listen to, but what is the point I'm going to make? And I'm really glad that she brought that up, because it isn't just with storytelling. A lot of people, when they're public speaking, they like to use gimmicks to grab people's attention, a prop or start with a crazy question. And it really, in my opinion, only works if it's guided by your intention and your purpose, whatever the larger message is. You don't just tell a story for the sake of it. You don't just use a prop for the sake of it. It has to make sense in the context of what you're doing.
Mm-hmm. I think one good example from the clips you showed today was that mom, I'm blanking on her name now, but the mom who was talking and how she was so inclusive, right? The story was that she had lost her son, but she didn't really talk about that as much as she talked about where that left us all. And I thought that was really the most powerful thing about that.
Yeah, character. Julia Jackson, by saying she's praying for the officers and, mm-hmm. God didn't invent one kind of horse or one kind, I can't remember all the flowers,
grasses. It's beautiful.
With you, because she is using the power of her words to embrace us rather than divide us, which is not really what we've seen this year. And she could have used her story, but she chose not to, because maybe she thought it would be too polarizing.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think, as you say, you have to think about what's your aim, right? And so, you as a mother of a murdered child, you can, approach it as victim. You can approach it with anger. You could, in sorrow is your defining principle. And, all of those would sort of be acceptable, right? Or at least understandable, right? But I think that what she realized was that if she wanted to actually move the conversation, that those were not the things that were going to benefit that.
Exactly.
So she chose to focus on other things. Well, I think that's all of our questions. This has been a really wonderful presentation. I do see we have a lot of thank yous and all that. Just want to put up Jillian's website up on the screen. All of you can reach out. Check out more about her there. I want to thank you again, Jillian, so much for such a thoughtful and provocative conversation. I really enjoyed it and I really learned things, which, is exciting.
Thank you.
But thank you so much, and to my team for all the support that they give, and to the audience for coming and showing up. And we will, just as a reminder, send a recording of the video tomorrow to everyone who was registered. So you can, you know, memorize those 5 points. I know I have. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you so much. Feel free to contact me.
Good night.
Good night.